Giant Voice.
The official podcast of the U.S. Navy's largest overseas installation, Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka. This is the Giant Voice Podcast.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Giant Voice Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Fluellen, and on this episode, we're circling back around to mental health awareness. We've been talking about it a lot recently with the kind of home port switch episode series, and today we're going to do a little bit more of a big picture, right? We're going to talk through some of the kind of steps that one can take with self-care, and just basically like keeping your mental health in a good way. So just like last time, I have a bunch of very smart ladies in the room with me. And just like last time, I'm a little intimidated, but that's okay. So with me today, why don't you start on my left here?
Dave, good morning, everybody. And thank you for having me.
So
my name is Captain Maria Bearfield. And I'm a Navy occupational therapist. I've been in the Navy for over 25 years. And what I'm here today is I just want to convey, you know, some of the tools and the strategies that I've used, not only just in my personal life as a sailor, you know, leader and officer in the Navy, but also as a mental health provider. I'm passionate about mental health. I'm passionate about the relationship between the mind, body, and soul. And I really want to highlight how the Navy's programs, the Warrior Toughness and the EOS program, they actually been instrumental in my life. And for me, I had something that happened to me. And because of the concepts from that program, it really did change my life.
Wow.
So what I want to do is the same way that it helped me, I want to help others, especially our service members, our family members, heal. And I want to also help take away the stigma and the stereotype when it comes to mental health. So I just want to share some of those tools and those strategies and then the services that we have, not only just at the hospital, but here in Japan, to help our sailors and family members heal from whatever's going on, whether it's stress, you know, especially with the port changes you're talking about,
yep.
The family members, the stress in relationships, stress at home. And I want to really emphasize the importance of the warrior mindset, peak performance, and how everything works together so that we can be the best that we can, so we can be fit mentally and physically and then ready for the fight.
I love it. I think that's a very noble mission, and I'm excited to get into all those topics today. All right, next up.
Good morning, everybody. I am HM2 Shayla Coleman.
Welcome back.
Thank you. I have been in the military for about 7 years. This year will be my 8th year. I have seen mental health throughout my whole life. I have been a military kid before, and now I'm in the service. My dad served, so I've seen it on both sides impact spouses, children, and also our active duty members and reservists as well, right? And I've seen it on the Army side and the Navy side. And I think mental health is important, and it's very important to have these conversations. And like Captain Bearfield pointed out, to kind of stop the stigma around mental health. And that is why I became a BHT. I think it's important to have these conversations outside the military and inside the military.
You know, it's a recurring theme. I think a lot of people I meet in the mental health field got into it because someone helped them, and then they feel almost like a calling to go help other people.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's really respectable. So great to have you back, as
thank
always.
You.
All right. And next up.
All right. Good morning, Dave. Thank you for having me here today.
Of course.
I am Lieutenant Iguana Akpuduwado, and I'm a clinical psychologist at DMH, and you can find us at E22. What do I do there? I provide clinical care to patients, so in the terms of providing therapy, evaluations. I also work at the Substance Abuse Rehabilitation Program, where we see patients who struggle with alcohol use or any form of substance abuse. So I'm excited to talk more about mental health and substance use and how we can engage in healthy behaviors rather than resort to substance use, in a sense.
That's excellent.
Thank you.
Okay, great. So let's start with this, and we can all sort of, you can all jump in. So why mental health? What's the importance of talking about it in a forum like this, in sort of a public forum? Why?
I think one, I forgot who mentioned it, just addressing the fact that there's a stigma around mental health. So the fact that even though there's been a push for people to talk more about their mental health struggles, people still struggle with the fact that it's hard to just open up and say, hey, I'm struggling with depression. Hey, I'm struggling with the fact that I can't wake up in the morning and things like that. So I think the more we talk about it, it's helpful and it's impactful and actually shows that you're not alone. So someone could be listening to this right now and they didn't know that, oh, there's a story that will be told today. And they're like, wow, I really resonate with that. So, and that might actually encourage them to actually seek help. So that's one. And I'll just pass this on to someone else rather than take up time.
So the first question I heard was, what is mental health? Mental health usually refers to a person's emotional, psychological, and social well-being, and it can affect how someone feels, how they act, and how they handle different levels of stress. I think it's important to have the discussion around mental health because it's a part of you from childhood to adulthood, and it can enhance a person's ability to have a life worth living and how they cope with the challenges that they face through their life. And like I said, like through childhood, you know, bullying, you know, dealing with the home port shift, having to say goodbye to a loved one that you might not see for months or even years, to adulthood, like how you move in your relationships, your personal relationships, your relationships with your friends, not just intimate ones, but even those ones that are platonic, really is important. Having poor mental health can be a negative impact, not just on the one person it's affecting, but also the people that is around that person.
Right.
So when you practice those good coping skills that ma'am brought up and have good mental health, you do that by using self-care, seeking support, and practicing those healthy coping mechanisms.
Great. Mm-hmm. You have anything to add?
Well, one of the things that I want to talk about is people don't realize that mental health impacts us in so many ways. For example, I'm going to tell you something. I believe people can die from a broken heart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And for example, and I'm going to share my story because I'm hoping that it resonates with somebody. For example, in 2018-19, you know, in the Navy, you know, we have to always show up 100%. I was, you know, I had a great job. I loved my job. I went from being a director here, I was here before, to then being a military assistant and back in Navy headquarters. And then I found out I didn't get selected for captain. I was devastated.
Yeah.
I've never known a broken heart until I found out I didn't get selected for a promotion. Like 2 days later, I was trying to get out of my car and I couldn't walk into the building. Mm. I was physically sick. My body hurt. I was trembling. I nobody could figure out what was wrong with me. And then I realized is like I was physically, my body was reacting to my emotional health. Broken heart.
It's all connected, right?
Oh, it's that mind, body, soul connection. And, you know, that's what, you know, to me, I'm going to talk about the warrior toughness. These programs really work. And one of the things that I did is I looked at it from this way. I looked at it because we know, you know, for example, warrior mindset is being able to take a hit and keep on fighting, you know, perform under pressure and then excel in the day in and day out grind. So then we know how that mind, body, and soul is connected. My soul was broken. So what I ended up doing, I had to decide. So I had to commit to myself that I was going to fight for my health. So I said, and I'm a woman again, I said, Lord, if you help me heal my body and my mental health, I will spend the rest of my life helping other people do it. So first I had to decide. And then what I started doing, I started using the principles. So for example, I had to commit. So I had to decide my what. What do I want? I want to serve. I love the Navy and I want to keep on serving. Then I had to realize the why, because of those that we serve. Like all of us here in this room, we're in the Navy. We're mental health providers. We're providers because we care about our sailors.
Absolutely.
And then so then what I started doing is I had to learn how to heal my body. So I didn't know how to do it. So I had to do it. I had to learn how to, one, I had to learn how to eat better. That's when I got into podcasts. I got into nutrition. I started working on the mind. I started learning self-care and things like that. I started taking classes. But it was not until I worked on my mind that it made the game changer. That's when I learned about mindfulness. I learned about meditation. I learned about yoga. I learned about, you know, taking care of the body, nutrition, you know, going for a walk and things like that. But I had to decide. I had to think differently. And I had to use my mind to heal my body. And one of the things that I learned is nobody's going to save us.
Yeah, that's right.
We have to decide and we have to do it for ourselves.
There's always kind of, right, we have a support network we lean on. But at the end of the day, we are wholly responsible for the trajectory of our own lives. Mm-hmm. And that can be a tough lesson to really internalize, right? It's one thing to know something intellectually. It's another thing to really emotionally understand
that.
It, right?
Yes.
And that moment in your life when you go, oh, yes, it's on me to do this. Mm-hmm. I feel I'm right there with you.
Yeah. And it starts with that self-talk,
right?
With that mind, working on your mind. And I'm going to tell you something. I just kept on keeping my what and my why. And it took me a couple years to do it. And I kept on. I never dropped my pact. I kept on working on my mind. And we're going to talk about self-care. Self-care is so important.
100%.
So important. And you know what? 2 years later, I finally made it and I got picked up. And I swore that if I would get picked up for promotion, I would spend the rest of my Navy career and my life helping others heal. Because if I could do it, you could. Anybody can do it too.
And here you are.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
I love it. That's fantastic. Thank you so much for sharing that story. It means a lot. And I hope it resonates with people listening as well. That's incredible. The whole connection there between the mind and body is really an amazing thing when you get down to it. And the self-talk, that's one of the reasons why I feel like CBT worked for me is like, I'm not an expert here. I just know how it affected me. But like, you get into these cycles of self-talk, right? And then it's so hard to break yourself out of that. And so you have to start in this really small way. But then it's like, once it gets moving, it suddenly just moves and you're like, oh, right, okay, it's good. Yeah. Like, I don't need to worry. Like,
and you catch yourself.
Yeah.
When you start thinking negatively, you start catching yourself.
Exactly, yes. Yeah, it's
and
amazing.
You change it. Yep.
And you can trace it back and you go like, why am I upset? Oh, that stupid thing I read on the internet 5 minutes ago made me think about this bad experience, which made me have this emotional response, now I'm anxious. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right?
That
like
is
it's
true.
It's so crazy to watch how your brain spins. Mm-hmm. So that's really great that you shared that, and I connect with it,
and just really, to add to that, since we keep using CBT, for whoever is listening, CBT stands for Cognitive Behavioral Therapy.
That's right. Thank you.
And it's based on the premise that the way you behave might impact your thoughts, which then impacts your behaviors. Mm-hmm. Just to clarify that, since we keep using CBT.
And yeah, I appreciate
I'm
that.
Also promoting the idea that you can also download these apps to look up CBT on App Store, and you will find something that will be helpful for you as well.
Mm-hmm. Right. And thank you for clarifying that. We're making the assumption that people know what it means. But yeah, so that's great. Yeah. And it's relatively modern as therapy goes, cognitive behavioral therapy. Am I correct in that?
It's been around for a long time now.
Okay.
I think it's just beginning to pick up more grasp.
In the public sphere.
Exactly.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. All right. Well, let's just talk about real quick, like the big picture of mental health in the Navy, right? What's the importance, like fleet-wise, Navy-wise, readiness-wise? Why do we need good mental health in our sailors? I mean, beyond the obviously human element that we don't want anyone to suffer and be in distress, but what's the importance? How does mental health keep the fleet ready for something like a home port shift, let's say?
No, that's a good question. And it to me is, for example, stress. Like, for example, you have families that, you know, PCS, I'm going to tell you, I've been in the Navy over 25 years, and PCSing is still stressful.
Mm-hmm.
So with a port change, you know, you have families PCSing again, you don't know what to expect and things like that. So then your emotions, you start getting anxious, you know, am I going to find a good school for my children? You know, I'm going back to the States, the economy, am I going to be able to find a home and things like that? And the reason is so important, especially for now, is so then, you know, so that our sailors, their family member and their children have tools so then they can cope with the things that are going on, stress. You know, do they have community? Do they have the skills? If the husband has a really hard day because, oh, they got to make sure that the ship is ready or, you know, that everything's taken care of during the day. Can they gather themselves before they walk into the door? And let me just take a couple of breaths. Let me recalibrate. Let me do a mental scan. Let me do a body scan before I walk in the door and before I offload on my wife or my kids.
Right.
Do they know that there are tools available out there that they can use before they walk home to even relax before they even walk home to maybe the wife is sick or you have three kids that are sick and you're stressed out just to be able to just, you know, just go back into balance.
Right.
So it's important. And that's just one example. You know, the kids are sick or whatever's going on. It's really important, especially with this home port change. It's stressful.
Right.
Change is stressful. It's stressful.
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah. I agree with that. So going back to your question about why this is important in the Navy, given the times we're in, we do need a fully readily deployable force. So we need people who are able to act when they're given a certain command. And if a person is worried or if they're anxious or too anxious to act, then we're not fully ready.
Right.
So for that reason, one, in essence, we do need the mental health of our sailors at a peak levels in preparation for whatever it is that's coming our way. Hopefully we don't have to. But if we do, we do need people who are mentally ready. And also in thinking of a home port shift, we are going on a ship that has over 5,000 people. While as a psychologist, the push is for us to become more in operational settings, my experience so far has been working at a hospital. So having to go on a 10-day underway, and by day three, I was kind of thinking, when am I getting off the ship? So I can only imagine what it's like to be on a ship for months and not have the opportunity to get off that ship. At least at work, I can go home at 7 o'clock and say, oh, I'll see them tomorrow.
Right.
But on a ship, you can't do that. So right. I can only imagine what it's like if you don't have, if your mental health is not stable.
That's right.
Or you don't have the right coping skills to manage those moments when you're feeling stressed. So yes, we do need sailors who are in the right mental state on ships, especially during home port shifts.
I think it's very important that you brought up the ship and the home port shift. When I think about it, I think about my husband. I'm dual mil. And I hear all the stories. He comes home, he tells me when he is home, and even when he's not, right? So we use Messenger to communicate because that's all they got.
That's all you got.
And he tells me that his team, his medical team, is what holds him together, having those bonds, having those relationships. You have to, because those
that's
are the people
you
that you
underway.
See day in and day out. And even on the ship, they try to practice good coping skills by having like talent shows and trying to implement, like, make sure you go to the gym on the ship or maybe go run around and go outside, just look at the dolphins or look at the sunset if you can.
Yep.
And or trying to make your rack as comfortable as possible.
Yeah, everybody got the blankets and the pillows.
Yes. Yes. And, you know, trying to, as you said, like, make light of the situation.
You laugh
right?
a lot. Mm-hmm. It's the best medicine underway. It's
yes.
Just laughing.
And a lot of time in the, since joining the Navy, I hear a lot of times of embrace the suck, right? Just embrace it. But when do we process it?
Right.
When can I process this suck? And so I tell my husband, like, hey, make sure you, like, do genuine check-ins with your guys. Make sure to check up on each other. Because, yes, we can embrace the suck and keep it moving and keep it pushing. But when are we asking, hey, how are you doing? Have you checked in with your family? You just had a new baby. How is your baby doing? Like, asking those type of questions and genuinely doing those check-ins with each other is practicing good mental health and coping
right.
skills.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think that's a perfect segue to talk about self-care a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. So let's talk about some self-care So what is self-care, right? And then maybe some, what are some things that we could practice maybe here in Japan and also underway? So what is self-care? Can someone give me kind of a definition?
So self-care, in my own definition, is taking care of oneself, right? Making sure that you're practicing that self-awareness, doing that check-in with yourself, and then doing something that may be a hobby or something that's out of your comfort zone, and just making sure to push yourself to continuously, that is going to pour back into your cup. The analogy I always use in group therapy is everyone is like a glass of water. We have these different areas in our life. So I might have my sailors, I might have my husband, my family, my brother, my sisters, my cousins, and I'm pouring into them my job. I'm pouring into all of these areas of my life, and I'm making sure that they're okay. But what am I doing to pour back into my cup? Who's pouring back into me when I'm by myself or when I need a recharge? Am I recharging myself? Am I putting that water back in? So what am I doing? Am I taking that big picture and pouring back into myself? And how do I do that? Personally, what I do is just try to practice good self-care with spa days and making sure I have my hair done, because those are the things that make me feel good so that I can continue to pour back into the people in my life and into my job and into my sailors. So I've heard hobbies like going on walks, walking my dog, journaling, reading a book. Anything of those things to help you pour back into yourself, taking a bath. A lot of the times I hear junior sailors where they've only had a shower their whole time. They would love to just take a bath. I say, hey, yep, go get a hotel room, get a bathtub, and just relax.
That's the best right there.
Mm-hmm. And just soak and just let your body just be free and let go and give yourself the space to just be with yourself.
The space to do nothing, to not have to be useful to anybody else is... important sometimes, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, a lot of things too is not to isolate yourself too.
Right.
Because community, for example, this is such an amazing country. There is so much to you. You have MWR trips.
Yep.
I consider that self-care too.
100%.
For example, I'm a big hiker because I know there's a Japanese word for forest bathing.
Yeah, I can't remember.
I can't remember either. Yeah. I love going hiking. I'm a big hiker. There's hiking groups here with Americans. There's a hiking group. There's a hike with the Fleet Rec Center. You know, I've been hiking with Tetsuya here for over 20 years. I was here the first time in 2002. Those hiking trips are fantastic. The MWR, the hiking trips. There's so get out. Don't isolate yourself. That's also, to me, I also consider that self-care. It's just getting out and being around other people.
In addition to self-care, because I know it's a word, and oftentimes there's that idea of you need to have good work-life balance. I think with self-care also comes self-acceptance and accepting what is. So sometimes it's knowing that for now, I may not be able to practice as much as I want to in terms of practicing self-care. But if I can get these things done in this moment, maybe this weekend, I'm going to dedicate this weekend to this.
Gotcha.
Right? So it's like creating that space for you to be able to take care of yourself later while you know in this moment, kind of like Captain Bearfield mentioned, is that warrior toughness mindset. You have to act now and later you can relax later.
Got it. Right? Yeah, that makes sense. I was going to say too, you can do an experiment of stay in all weekend and see how you feel Monday morning. And then the next weekend, be with people and be in a situation that is, nurturing with other people and see how you feel Monday morning. And it's really easy nowadays to get stuck into doom scrolling on your phone for 48 hours. And, that's not self-care, right? We're just making ourselves more anxious.
That is true.
You know what, though? I have to admit, so last Friday, I have to admit, I take one day a week and I binge watch.
Yeah, why not? Yeah,
I'm a big fan of Viking movies.
Yeah.
I stayed up all Friday night watching The Last Kingdom. I watched, and to me, that was self-care.
Mm-hmm. I got to tell you this. I got an award for something the other day. This won't go in the podcast. I got an award for something. There was a guy I haven't seen since I was active duty, right? So it's years. And so the last time he saw me, I looked like an active duty guy. And I got up to accept the award, and it took him a second to realize it was me. And he stopped me, and he's like, bro, you look like a Viking.
Yeah. Your haircut,
I guess, yeah.
I thought the same when I saw you.
I did, too.
You do.
I did, too.
You do look like a Viking.
You do. I did, too.
Well, all
that's why I had to mention it.
That,
yeah, right. And you know, exactly. And that to me was a laugh. You see, it was fun. That's self-care.
It's great. Laughing is the best medicine.
Shoot the breeze with a whole bunch of people. Yep. That is self-care.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you know another one that I do, and I've seen people do it. People don't realize that when you massage your hands, there's some research to show that if you massage your hand, it's also self-care.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It releases stress. If you don't, you know, if you realize, you see people doing it and they don't realize what they're doing. They're actually getting rid of stress.
Wow.
By just massaging their hands.
So let's ask this question. So is drinking alcohol to cope with stress self-care?
No, it's not.
No, it's not. So
it's a form, I guess, okay, for lack of a better word. Some may classify it as self-care, but then we would go into the realm of, is this helpful self-care or unhealthy self-care?
Right.
Right. So when we say self-care, we're saying only healthy forms of caring for yourself. And to a certain extent, yes, maybe having a few drinks with your friends.
With friends and having a laugh.
Yes, and having a laugh is good, but to the point where it becomes dysfunctional, or that's your way of coping, or every time you feel down, you feel stressed, you're like, oh my God, I have to drink right now.
Yeah.
That's no longer self-care. Now we're coping with alcohol.
Using it, that was kind of one of my things, was using it to avoid uncomfortable feelings.
Mm-hmm.
So not so much a dependency on it, but this thing of like when something uncomfortable happens, going, I don't want to feel that. That's icky.
Yeah.
Let me do this, and then I'm numb and I don't have to feel it.
Yeah.
But then you get into a cycle where then you do or say something stupid, mm-hmm. and that leads to more icky feelings, mm-hmm. which then leads to more drinking.
Exactly. I tend to see that pattern happening where people are stressed out at work, and as a result of that, they feel like there's no other thing they can do besides go to the next 7-Eleven, get a few true highs, and they get tipsy, and something happens the next morning, show up to work late, and then you're referred to SARP.
And
right?
The cycle
continues. Yeah. But hope that's why we're here today, to kind of recommend a few things that you can do outside of resorting to alcohol use.
So I think that's another perfect segue, right? We can talk a little bit about so we're talking about self-care, kind of baseline good mental health. When is the time that it's like, okay, what are some flags that are going to say, maybe I need to go to someone in the Navy and I need maybe some help to deal with something that's going on? What are some signs that one might notice about themselves going, hey, it's time for some help?
I would say, one, if you notice you're finding it hard to wake up in the morning. So every time you wake up, you just feel that sense of dread of having to go about your day.
Interesting.
I've heard people talk about when they get to work, they had this nut in their stomach that they had to throw up. Or you find yourself just having, feeling disconnected from your friends or feeling disconnected from family members. Being that it's Mental Health Awareness Month, you might be having thoughts that you'd be better off just going to sleep and not waking up. So at that point, we do want people to come to mental health and seek help in those situations.
Yeah, I agree with ma'am. If you find yourself wanting to separate yourself from loved ones, a simple task like washing the dishes, washing your clothes, clothes are starting to pile up. You come home, go to work, come home, go to work, kind of get into that routine, or feel like you just want to sleep for hours, don't want to get up, just want to lay in your bed and not do anything. The things that you do for self-care isn't working anymore. So your hobbies are not working for you anymore. You know, taking those baths ain't working anymore. Then those are the signs that you want to look out for. And maybe it's time to go to that higher level of care.
Okay. You have anything to add?
To me, for me as an occupational therapist, is when you stop engaging in activities of daily living.
Okay.
For example, right. The same thing that both of the young ladies said. For example, for a big one is isolation, and when you start taking care of yourself, and you know any activity of daily living, which is a community, like dressing, bathing, getting up.
I've heard that before, like a change in hygiene patterns mm-hmm. and things like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would also add, when you find yourself having more arguments with your friends or having interpersonal problems for a reason,
yeah.
right? So something has changed in you where you're getting more irritable or you might notice your friends might be like, hey, Dave, why are you, what's
got
you?
What's the deal, man? Yeah, like, why are you so angry recently?
So it's, and oftentimes just going to that idea of CBT you had mentioned before, it's, you don't even know these things are happening or that you're struggling with mental health. Someone else could be the one to point it out to you like, hey, I've noticed you're drinking a lot lately, or I noticed you're sleeping a lot lately. What's up with that? Mm-hmm. You're not eating as much as you should, or you're eating more than you usually do.
Right.
But
some kind of change from baseline that is noticeable.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? The key to that is we usually get triggered. Like if somebody tells us, I remember when I got back from
we get angry about it. Right.
And that happened to me. I was in Afghanistan for a year and I came back and I didn't realize I was angry. If anybody knows me, they know I am like the sweetest person in the world. And anytime somebody would talk to me, I was always angry.
Yeah, bite their head off.
And I remember a good friend of mine that says, Maria, something's wrong with you. You're angry. And then I said, I'm not angry. And then I realized, it's like, oh my gosh, I am angry.
Yeah.
And it's when somebody tells us there's something off, just for us to take a pause and say, oh my gosh, maybe they're right. Mm-hmm. Instead of us getting triggered, because it's human for us to get triggered when somebody points something out. Just to take a second and say, can that be true? I had a great boss that once told me, every time somebody tells you something, just remember there's always a grain of truth in it.
Right.
So maybe it's okay if a friend tells me, if Lieutenant AK says, you know, ma'am, you're being angry. Instead of being angry, I say, okay, let me just take a second. Oh my God, is that true?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And because it's so easy for us to get triggered, especially if we are depressed, if we are anxious, if we're nervous. Maybe we should take a pause before we react. Instead of reacting, let us take a second and respond.
Right.
Yeah, that is true. And that's where self-reflection comes in, which is a lifelong goal for a lot of people.
Yep.
So
to look at ourselves.
Yes.
Man, that's the hardest thing to do in the world,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
To truly see who you are
it's not
an easy path to walk, is it?
Yeah, no.
But you know what? Just like everything is practice.
Yeah, that's right.
I remember in yoga, I love going to yoga. And the teacher always says, it's not a yoga class. It's a practice.
Right.
Because it's something that you'll be practicing for the rest of your life.
Mm-hmm.
And I know for me, for example, when I came back from Afghanistan and I was starting to be angry, that's when I started doing yoga and meditation. And I haven't graduated yet. You know, I still get triggered sometimes, but at least now I catch myself faster.
Yeah.
And to me, I use meditation as a form so that I don't react and that I learn to respond. But like Lieutenant AK said, it's a lifelong journey.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Fleet and Family, the Fleet Rec offers some yoga classes as well. So mm-hmm. if you're interested.
I don't really do yoga. I've done a little bit for physical stuff. Mm-hmm. But I do practice meditation, and it really does help me. Just Vipassana, like thinking about your thoughts, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And just like noticing how your thoughts go.
Yeah.
It helps me calm down in the morning anyway. Yeah. When I'm on my way to work on the train, like I don't want to go to work. Like, yeah.
For example, I love this mental health roadmap because again, where it says we need to learn the tools, skills, and strategies so we can take care of ourselves first. And I always say, nobody's going to save me. I have to learn how to save myself. And I love it here. Like, for example, even the first step start here. Are you feeling stressed, need help, but don't know where to start? For example, there's a lot of resources here. We're just talking about yoga. At the Fleet Rec, they do yoga classes throughout the day. There's a yoga class every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 6:00 in the morning. They offer yoga. So that's a way if you want to get in tune with your body. One of them is, yoga. I'm going to tell you something. I prepare for the PRT, for the plank, doing yoga.
Yeah, it's great for it. Right?
Yeah, yoga, and I can max out my plank just from doing yoga. And then the other thing is helps me get relaxed. The way we start our day is the way the rest of the day is going to go. I do yoga 3 times a week. I start out in peace. I can deal with whatever comes. For example, we have Credo. Credo has a marriage enrichment sessions. They have resiliency retreats. They have date night. For people who just need a date night, they cover everything. Credo is an untapped, amazing resource that we have here on base. Lieutenant Ake was talking about the fleet. We have the Navy Family Fleet and Service Center. They have counselors. There's a lady, a Japanese lady, that does a resiliency boot camp, six sessions.
Little plug for them, too. Mm-hmm. I actually was just over there yesterday because I'm making a video for them. They are now doing online mental health care services.
Oh, wow.
So there are
tons of services here. And if people don't know where to begin, even in the CFA, the websites, go in there, look for MWR or Family Fleet and Service Center and Credo. There's tons and tons of services.
And we'll also have all those resources in the show notes as well. Okay, cool. So let's talk about, we touched on it a little bit at the beginning, but common misconceptions about mental health, right? What are some common misconceptions about seeking care, about what's going to happen? I feel like I need to talk to somebody. What are some misconceptions about what happens next? Let's say my command has said I potentially have some kind of substance abuse issue. And now, what are some common misconceptions about what people think is going to happen next?
This is quite unfortunate. I forget the term that they call psychologists on the ship. But one major misconception I always get is that people feel they're going to get kicked out or their career will end one way or the other the moment they talk to mental health. And I try to make it clear to them that's not my goal in doing this. I'm here to provide the best care you need and to advocate for you as a sailor, as well as being an officer to you as well. So that's one major misconception. But however, that's really not the goal of psychologists. We're here to make sure that we can get you back into the force. And I think on the other hand, too, there's the misconception that in mental health, we help people get out of the Navy or the military. But that's really not our goal either. Whenever we do feel that a person is not suitable or should not no longer continue their service, we will advocate for that. But that's not our role either way. Our role is to make sure that we have people who are able to do the job that they are assigned to do in the Navy. Unless you guys have other ones, I think that's a major one.
I think one that I hear on a daily basis is, I'm weak if I go, or I'm no longer this strong person, and that's not true. It takes a lot of strength to actually look within yourself and do that self-awareness and self-check with yourself and be like, I need help. So I think people who come and they get to that point where they're like, I need substance abuse help or I need mental health help, it takes a lot of courage and it takes a lot of strength to do that. Another thing I usually hear is that I'm going to get in trouble or I'm going to get kicked out. And like ma'am just stated, that's not our goal, right? We want to get you back in the fight. We want to get you to where you are healthy and where you can implement the tools and the skills that you learn. And also, another thing I hear is that if I go to mental health, everything's going to be fine. Everything's going to be better in just a blink.
Magic pill either.
Right. We're not magicians. We're not wizards, even though on the Marine side, I hear they call us wizards, mental wizards. We don't have a magic wand that's going to fix everything, right? Our job is to give you these skills and these tools for your mental health toolbox and to make it strong and to give you the keys to your toolbox to be like, this is what I can use in this situation. I feel stressed. Let me go to this healthy coping mechanism that I learned in group or with my therapist or social worker. So just some common things that I've heard personally.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things also, there's research that shows that leadership who support mental health, those sailors, there's the research that I've read have been done more in the Army. What they were looking is the people who actually seek mental health and those that actually improve and continue. So there's research. I mean, don't quote me on this, but I remember I was reading an article that leaders who actually support mental health initiatives, their sailors or their service members tend to go to mental health
I would thrive say better.
They thrive better and they do better when it's a culture that supports it. And another thing is I read an article that was talking about, they were also talking about interventions. Like if you give mental health interventions before you go on deployment, before you, as something happens, right after something happens.
Yes, I've seen this too, yeah.
And it shows that if you give resources, get resources definitely before, but the most efficient, effective resource is as soon as something happens. So if you either have a bad day, then you go take care of yourself immediately. Go do some self-care, take care of yourself. But I think the answer to your question is, another key to add to what the two young ladies says is leadership support of mental health.
Mm-hmm. And I also want to add, especially for SARP, which is the Substance Abuse Rehabilitation Program, a lot of sailors tend to look at SARP in a punitive light. So they think that because something happened, whether it was an alcohol-related incident, and my command has sent me here, this is a punishment. But the goal of SARP is not that. We're not punitive in nature. We're here to address whatever it was that led you into increased alcohol use or problematic alcohol use and to get you back in the fight, like HM2 Coleman mentioned. So I do want to clarify that as best as possible that in SARP, and you can self-refer as well. So it's actually better when you self-refer to SARP when you're struggling with any form of substance abuse, rather than for something to happen and your command refers
be
you.
Be forced to.
Yes. And in that, when you do self-refer, we do our best to care for you and to make sure this is not a situation where your command now has to do something in terms of punishing you for something that they otherwise wouldn't know had you not come to SARP. So that's not our role. So please do come to SARP if you do have any struggles with alcohol use. We'll be there for you.
And I'll say, as a prior active duty and had my own issues with alcohol, that sometimes it's so hard to even see that you're underwater when you're underwater. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
It's so, you just think everything is normal.
Yeah.
And I think that's why some people wait until something happens because they don't know they're below the surface.
Yeah.
But I would just say, take a look around you. And if your life right now is working on the ship and then going out drinking and that's your life, then you might need to go talk to somebody.
A few signs if you're drinking more than you intend to. If you're getting into fights, that is worsened by alcohol use. If you've noticed that you can drink more before you get tipsy and other people are telling you, hey, you're drinking
a
lot
tank,
more.
You're a tank, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So those are some signs that, okay, maybe I am drinking more than the average person that's my age, right? So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, not awesome, but good,
good information.
Good information. Yeah, I overuse that word quite a bit. Yeah. Common misconceptions. And then, resources, mental health resources specifically that are available beyond self-care. Occupational therapy, coping skills group, warrior toughness, that's something you wanted to kind of talk about a little bit more. So why don't we get into that now?
Well, so what I did is it's a coping skills group. And it's every Monday at the Fleet Rec at the Wellness Center.
Okay.
And it's from 9 to 10:30. And what I do I believe these programs are excellent and they work. The Warrior Toughness programs and the EOS programs, these programs work. But we have to apply them to
right.
our lives. Again,
right.
we have to heal ourselves. So what I've done is I've developed groups that I'm holding based on these principles. For example, we know how thoughts, emotions, and behavior affect peak performance. So what I do is I have a group on behavior and how behavior and personality affect peak performance. One of them is, I'm going to tell you something, we can, you know, do self-care and this stuff too. For example, we want to feel appreciated at work.
Yeah, 100%.
I'm going to tell you something. One thing that I've learned, I worked in, before coming here to Japan, I was I worked at a Brooke Army Medical Center. And I was teaching at Baylor. And one of the things that I discovered that a lot of the service members that I was seeing in mental health was they just want to be seen, heard, and appreciated.
Yep.
And then so
I think everybody does all the time, right?
Exactly. Yeah. We want to be seen. So I have a group on behavior. I have a group on appreciation. When people don't give it to us, how we can learn how to give it to ourselves.
Oh, interesting.
One group is on emotional intelligence. One definitely on goals. And then once we set our goal, it's then mindset. How do we use our mindset to get to our goals and to ensure we get peak performance? And then I have definitely a group on a meditation and movement, you know, mindful movement, yoga and stretch. Cool. So my goal is to try to now use those great programs that the Navy already has, is implement them so that we can use them, and then so that we can start helping ourselves heal, and then so we can be ready for the fight. So what I've done is I've taken the principles from these two programs and developed groups so then we can apply them, and then so then our service members can do it for themselves, and then take them back to the ship, take them back to the submarine,
spreads, yeah.
So then they can spread and they can help one another. Because like Lieutenant AK was saying, if one of your buddies says, hey, you're drinking a little bit more, then you know, you know, hey, you know, this is what I learned. Hey, let's do some recalibration. Let's do a body scan. What's going on? Is there something going on at home? Are you having a bad day and things like that? So this becomes common knowledge and common language so that we're helping each other. Because, for example, if you and I work together, I see you every day. So if something's off,
you notice.
I'm going to notice.
Yeah.
Hey, let's talk about, let's use some of these tools and techniques that are already available. Let's help each other. Sometimes, so that we can help one another.
Just the validation of having someone notice that you're not feeling right is so nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like when
yeah.
someone is just like, are you okay, dude?
Mm-hmm.
It's
yeah.
like, oh, man. No. No, I'm not.
Yeah. It was so funny. Just the story to tell. About 2 months ago, shout out to Captain Reed. She probably didn't know this. I was working a lot, and this was about 8:30 in the evening. I walked past her and she said, sit down, please. You're always walking around. Have a seat. How are you doing? And in that moment, I almost broke down into tears.
Yeah, I know.
And that was the first time where I felt like someone who was higher ranking actually stopped me and said, how are you doing? Are you actually taking care of yourself? So it was just really a very heartfelt moment to experience that with her, and just to see that someone's actually seeing me in that moment. Yeah.
Wow, that's a great, great story as well.
Yeah.
I love the idea of the groups that you're doing here. And if people want to know about that, we can put the information into the show notes for the podcast.
Yes, thank you.
Do they have to be referred to this group?
You know what? Right now we're just starting them, but we have been. Actually, I'm going to be honest. If anybody wants to come and just come check out the groups, just please come. I don't want to keep anybody from getting an opportunity to learn something. They may, you know, some of these groups may resonate, maybe not, but we can always learn something, a tool, skill, or something. So the answer is we will walk people in, but definitely it's welcome. Anybody's welcome.
So is that, are those groups for active duty or is that open to everybody?
So the focus, our target population is for active duty service members.
Okay. So those groups are going to be for active duty only, because that factors into the whole warrior mindset thing.
Yes, sir.
So those groups that you talked about are just, I really like that idea and the kind of direction you're talking about with the warrior mindset stuff. Let's talk a little bit about the CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy groups, and DBT, which I know last time you were on, you explained to me, but I'm getting old and I don't remember.
It's okay.
So if you'd explain a little bit about what those are, what they are, and how people access them.
So we have CBT and DBT, which is psychotherapy evidence-based groups. CBT is cognitive behavioral therapy. The way I think about CBT is what my mom usually tells me is change the way you think, change the way you live, right?
Right.
And realizing the things that I can control, which is the things within my reach, and the things that I cannot control, which is the things outside of me. So like my job, my paycheck, people, we can't control people.
Right.
And learning how to challenge those unhelpful thinking patterns, that distorted thinking. Out of CBT was birthed DBT, which is dialectical behavioral therapy. In DBT, there are four modules. There is mindfulness, emotion regulation, distress tolerance, and interpersonal effectiveness. DBT is usually geared towards individuals who experience emotions very deeply and very intensely. And it focuses on helping people accept their realities and learn how to get a life worth living. And CBT is on Mondays from 1300 to 1400, and then DBT is on Thursdays from 0830 to 1000. So
how do people access those sessions? Do they need to be referred, or?
Yes, you have to be with a provider and you have to be referred to the group. Great. So you have to be connected to someone to attend the groups. Yes, sir.
Okay. Excellent.
And I would add to that, a lot of times when I see patients or recommend them to DBT or CBT groups, they often have that apprehension of, oh, I don't want to talk in a group. Mm-hmm. But you come to find actually being in a group session makes people open up more about other things, because you start to see that other people are experiencing the same thing that you're experiencing. Mm-hmm. So while it may be anxiety provoking at first, you get to build a community of people who understand you even better than maybe other people on your ship that don't know what you're going through. Mm-hmm. So
a lot of times I hear in group is that I'm not connected to my family back home. It's very hard to get a hold of them, or I'm not connecting with anybody on my ship, or no one's understand what I'm going through. And that is what group is for. I always tell my group members that this is a place for you to share, and this is a place where you're not being judged. This is an open space, a safe space, and just hearing people have those same experiences as you and opening up as well and showing that vulnerability is important, and that this is a space of community. This is your community. This is the place for you to just be who you are. You don't have to wear that mask. You don't have to wear that rank. This is just you.
And you're doing it I think a lot of people try and craft that community on their own, maybe at the bar or mm-hmm. whatever, in an unhealthy way. Well, here's a healthy way to be able to get something more intimate, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. Like it.
And I want to add to that as well. So we have the pregnancy and infant loss group. So this is geared towards women who've had issues or concerns surrounding getting pregnant, or if you've lost a child. Currently, the groups are held at the Sakura Room on the first Wednesday of every month at 9 o'clock and the third Wednesday of every month at 6 p.m. Hopefully, in the near future, it's going to be moved to E22. So all these groups are held at E22, the groups that HM2 Coleman and Captain Bearfield mentioned. In the near future, in a couple of months, I'm also working on starting a women's group. So this will be geared towards women's mental health and just a support group for women in general and issues that we go through. So be on the lookout for that. And the more it's asked about, the more likely that I will actually create this sooner rather than later.
So ask about it.
Yes.
And Fleet and Family has a plethora of classes and sessions that they also offer. And they always put it out on their Facebook chat as well. So make sure to shout out to Fleet and Family, because they help support our active duty and spouses and children too on the base.
Right.
Mm-hmm. 100%. All right. Let's end on this. What is one way that you manage a stressor in your daily life? What's one tip that you could give to somebody for managing stress daily?
One tip.
We go with each person.
Okay.
Each person give one. It doesn't matter who starts.
I think I always try to find the humor in everything, right? So in as much as a day could be the most stressful day, the one thing I know most people who walk into my office would experience from me is that I would probably make you laugh about something. It could be something very silly. I tend to be goofy when I get comfortable with a person. So I try to find the humor in the small things. Even in the craziest day, I would find something funny about what happened that day.
It's a good tip.
Yeah.
For myself, I am a workaholic, and I get in my head very easily. So to combat that, one of the things that I do is to make sure I set very clear boundaries with myself and other people. Like I set alarms for myself to make sure I go get lunch, to go home at a decent time. If I'm not going home by 4, I'm at least going home by 5:30. And I try to make sure I stick to those because I know if I do not keep clear boundaries with myself, I'm going to work myself into the ground.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So those are some things that I do for myself to combat that stress, because in the moment, I'm like, I have to get it done. I have to get it done. I have to get it done right now. But a lot of the things, I might feel like that, but is that true? Is that factual? Or can it wait till the next day?
Yes, you do. You have to accomplish it right now.
I think it's a good point. There's, I'm not like you at all. I'm like 4 o'clock, it'll wait. But I know a lot of people in the Navy who are like you, and it actually can be a very admirable trait to have, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like me, it's like my balloon runs out of air and I'm just done. Like, that's it.
Yes.
But I do know a lot of people like you, who, right, they sometimes even I know those type of people, and I'll be like, bro, it's fine. It's gonna be there tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
Yeah, and I noticed with that, too, that it's very important to do that, because I started putting a lot of things first, and then my family, my spouse, everything else started to fall. My friends started to fall at the waistband, and everything started to revolve around work, which, yes, that made me very competitive. That made me very good at my job.
Yeah, it's a good trait in some ways, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. But, and I use it as my superpower, but at the same time, it can also be my kryptonite.
Right.
So when I started noticing that, if I have my lunch, I'm going on lunch and I'll call my mom or I'll text my husband or I'll do a check with myself to be like, what is going on with me today? And then I come back refreshed, more clear-headed and able to actually do more because I actually gave myself and told myself to have this break in this space.
I love it. Mm-hmm. All right, awesome. Ma'am?
For me, actually, it's spirituality. So I get up every morning and I read the Bible every morning, and I just take, whether it's just 1 minute, I just sit and meditate for like a minute, and I try to do it every day. But to me, my go-to is always spirituality.
I think that's great. To something bigger than ourselves is always a great way to kind of cope.
I'll add to that. Call your mom.
Call your mom.
Yeah.
She wants to hear from you.
Yeah.
Call your dad too while you're at it. Yeah. He probably wants to hear from
Father's
you.
Father's Day rolling up.
Yeah.
It's even funny. Like, for example, I'm going to be honest. One of my also big relievers is me and my sisters, we Snapchat.
Yeah.
All day. Yeah. I mean, they're Snapchatting me all day. I don't get to hear it till, you know, I either wake up in the morning. And that is such a stress reliever. Yeah. Family.
Yeah.
I also, too, like a lot of my Navy buds that I was on the ship with still have running group chats with of just like the stupidest stuff you could imagine.
Yeah.
But it's great. You're feeling stressed and there's something to put a smile
on your
face.
So what's your way to de-stress?
Right.
Be a Viking.
Pillage. Yes, I row in small boats. So the biggest one for me recently, especially in the past couple of years since my, drinking became not a big part of my life anymore, is meditation in the morning. I actually meditate on my train ride. I live quite far away. I take the train in. Japanese trains are nice and quiet. And so there's this misconception about meditation that you need to be burning incense and not true. You can meditate anywhere at any time. The train's quiet. Put white noise in my headphones, and I just do no mind meditation for 20 minutes in the morning. Feel like it, you know, I am the type of person who wakes up thinking about what I have to accomplish for the day. Mm-hmm. And that's already running through my head. And so meditation is kind of a way to put the brakes on everything and just go like, hey. Well, thank you, ladies, very, very much. This was really informative, and I hope that our listeners got some good information out of this. And, make use of the resources. There's so many resources. If you are coming over as part of the home port shift, everyone's told you already that living in a foreign country is going to be difficult, and it is, but they are here to tell you that there are plenty of resources to help you on this facility and in Japan in general. So please make use of them. And with that, that's a wrap on this episode. Thank you very much. And we will see you next time.
Thank you.
The Giant Voice Podcast is a production of Commander Fleet Activities Yokosuka Public Affairs Office. views expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the policy of the Department of the Navy or Department of Defense. Thanks for listening.